On Wednesday, July 17th, 2019, the Capital One security team was having a productive discussion regarding security and how to best secure their systems. While they were drafting a fake phishing email to send to all the employees, they were interrupted by an email in their own mailbox. This was a special responsible disclosure mailbox, which allows those who find exploits and leaks to responsibly disclose their findings. You can also just reach out through Twitter DMs, though. This was slightly alarming, but more often than not, these were minor bugs which would ideally be fixed before bad actors find out about them. However, the email stated that there appears to be some leaked S3 data of yours in someone's GitHub, so the damage was already done. For those unfamiliar with AWS, S3 stands for Simple Storage Service and is used to store files. The bucket is the highest level of organization. All folders and files must be in a bucket. Capital One was a big fan of the cloud, being the first major bank to fully migrate all their on-premises data centers to the cloud. This comes with many advantages. For example, rather than building their own data storage system and deploying and maintaining it across dozens of data centers across the world, Capital One can simply use S3. With AWS, Capital One also encrypted all of their S3 data, so perhaps the hackers somehow accessed the encryption keys or successfully launched the first quantum attack in history. Anyways, the security engineers examined the GitHub file linked in the email and noticed it was timestamped on April 21st, almost 2 months prior. The file itself did not contain any leaked data, but it contained three suspicious commands, which would allegedly download customer credit information from Capital One's AWS account when executed. The engineers tested the commands and found they did indeed work. This was grave news. Open up any terminal, copy-paste the commands, and bam, 30 gigabytes of Capital One data is now on your hard drive. Anyone with an internet connection, this GitHub page, and a pulse could have unrestricted access to an unknown amount of internal data. The damage here could be massive. In the worst case, these publicized commands were not telling the full story, and the hackers may have already infiltrated deep within the cloud. The engineers immediately escalated to their manager's manager, the CEO of the company, AWS, and the FBI. Now the question remains, what did these commands do? Well, AWS has a command line interface, or CLI. CLIs provide a way to interact with software through a command line. Obviously, the most ubiquitous example of these are Unix shells, but we also have the famous Git CLI for all your pushing and pulling needs. We also have everyone's favorite fish, the Docker CLI, and we can't forget the most important one of all, the Minecraft CLI. Anyways, using the AWS CLI is very simple. We retrieve AWS credentials for a particular role or user and load these credentials into the CLI. Then we are free to call whatever commands we want using this format. So the first command obtained AWS credentials for the role ISRM WAF role. Curl allows us to transfer data over HTTP. In this case, we are requesting data from this URL, which we will get to later. These three tokens are what AWS uses for authentication. Command number two simply lists every S3 bucket in the account, and the third command downloads the contents of any bucket returned by the prior command. This was mostly trivial stuff. Listing and downloading S3 content is something anyone can Bing and figure out how to do. Bing has failed me once again. It's using the outdated version 1 CLI for the list buckets call. Anyways, the interesting part was the first command which obtained the credentials. The hacker was curling this public IP address. This plus the role name allowed the engineers to narrow down their search to a particular web server they had running in AWS which served public internet traffic. Upon locating these resources, they revoked all active usage of the role, shut down the server, deleted the account, and went back to bed. On a more serious note, they can now investigate the scope of the attack. AWS provides an inescapable breadcrumb trail of all cloud usage, named Cloud Trail. By tracing this trail, the engineers found that there wasn't any ongoing suspicious activity. The malicious commands were only run from a period of time between March 12th and April 21st, when various IP addresses coming from Tor exit nodes and iPredator, a VPN service, downloaded 30 gigabytes of data containing 100 million credit card applications, approximately 120,000 social security numbers, and 77,000 bank account numbers. The revelation of this breach sparked fierce debate between cloud enthusiasts and their arch nemesis, the on-premises menace. The latter would insist that the cloud simply is not suitable for sensitive workloads. The former would say that doesn't really matter because you're at risk as long as you're connected to the internet. It does make sense to think that the cloud provider should take responsibility for securing customer resources. After all, we're paying to use your cloud, so shouldn't your cloud be secure? To this, Amazon would respond, security and compliance is a shared responsibility between AWS and the customer. This shared model can help relieve the customer's operational burden as AWS operates, manages, and controls the components from the host operating system and virtualization layer down to the physical security of the facilities in which the service operates. The customer assumes responsibility and management of the guest operating system, including updates and security patches, other associated application software, as well as the configuration of the AWS provided security group. As it turns out, security in the cloud is a two-way street. So what did Capital One do wrong? There were two key mistakes. First, the web server we talked about before that was open to the internet was susceptible to server-side request forgery. This is an exploit where private network resources are accessed through a request sent to a public server in the same private network. That is, the attacker forges a request that appears to be valid and sent from the server, where in actuality it was provided by the client. Put in even simpler terms, I can't directly get the answer key for the upcoming exam, so I talked to the TA, who doesn't perform input validation on my requests. Hey, can you ask the professor for the upcoming exam's answer key and give it to me? Then the TA gets the answer key from the professor, as there is mutual trust between them, and hands it back to me. Right, so the web server is the TA who is susceptible to SSRF and blindly forwards requests to downstream services. But who is the professor here? What is this magic service that gives me AWS credentials? Cloud providers like AWS GCP and Azure all provide a metadata service for cloud instances to retrieve useful information, like which region the instance is located in or what security group it's using. This metadata also includes the AWS role attached to the instance. EC2 instances, AWS's virtual computers, can have a role attached to it which determines its permissions. If we had an application running on EC2 that, say, needed to download something from S3, we'd have to attach a role with the correct permissions. The instance will then periodically call the metadata service to retrieve credentials for this role and use them to make authorized calls to S3. Capital One's web server running on EC2 was a reverse proxy, that is, a proxy server which sits in front of the backend services, directing requests to the correct targets. Capital One's server ran an open source web application firewall software called Mod Security, which should have acted as a security layer to protect against malicious requests. The backend service this server was intended to talk to was not revealed. However, a misconfiguration allowed the attacker to send requests to the instance metadata service and retrieve the instance credentials. Whatever rule sets they had configured did not include the metadata service address. Nowadays, this metadata threat is very well studied and pretty much non-existent, but hindsight is 20/20. Great, so the hacker can assume whatever role this EC2 instance was using. The second mistake was classic and very predictable. This role was overly permissive. It had read permissions for every S3 bucket, as well as permissions to decrypt everything, which allowed the hackers to download a ton of S3 data in plain text. This role unfortunately did not live up to its namesake. The hacker may have also installed some crypto mining software on the servers for good measure. Okay, so now we know when the hack was carried out, how it was carried out, and what they stole. Now, let's see who was behind it. Surely this would be quite difficult, as it is impossible to trace a Tor request back to its origin without tricks like traffic analysis, and iPredator did not seem like the type of company that would cooperate with federal investigators. Oh. It turns out the GitHub account which posted the file included a full name. It also included a resume where it indicated that Thompson was a systems engineer who formerly worked at AWS. They also found a server list of IP addresses which matched the IPs which Capital One saw in their logs. Lastly, Thompson was traced to multiple public messaging platforms, straight up admitting to the crime. So this situation seems to be Capital One's fault, but you could argue otherwise. For example, if you rear-end someone and are at fault for the accident, sure, it's your fault. But if you wanted to deflect blame at all costs, you could say that it was the car's fault because it didn't have automatic braking. I suppose it's up to interpretation whether or not AWS's inability to prevent this in the first place was equivalent to not having automatic braking or not having functional brakes in the first place. For a decade since the launch of EC2, AWS's metadata service, IMDS, relied on a simple GET request, which was essentially free lunch for open reverse proxies. There was no incentive to improve this, as it worked, and if it ain't broke, don't fix it. But the Capital One breach led many to question whether or not this was okay. AWS said it was, and that it wasn't their fault, but 4 months later, completely coincidentally, They overhauled their metadata service, adding the driver assist features previously missing. IMDSV2, had it existed at the time, would have thwarted the attack for three reasons. One, it requires an HTTP put to initiate the session, which is not supported by most reverse proxies or WAFs. Number two, it blocks the X-forwarded 4 header, which reverse proxies will add. And lastly, the response packet's time to live is set to 1, so it will only survive a single network hop to the direct caller. But how could Capital One have done better? RTFM and configure your firewall correctly? Actually, this SSRF bug wasn't the root issue here. Bugs are inevitable, but multiple levels of security had to fail here. Most obviously, there is least privilege. The role assigned to the instance should only have had permissions it needed. Although it's way easier to just give everyone access to everything, it may save your company a few bucks to do so. On the organizational side, Capital One had been expanding very aggressively in the cloud, and proper security reviews and penetration testing for new features may have been overlooked. The company's IT department grew 360% from 2,500 in 2011 to 9,000 in 2018. We are a software shop.
We build software.
The engineers also were free to build applications with 300 different languages and platforms, which made it difficult for the security team to properly monitor network traffic and spot problems. In the end, Capital One settled for $190 million. The hacker faced